These are the most dangerous waters in the world. This is a French fishing trawler. The water is getting more and more dangerous. Constant streams of tankers sail by. There are plenty of rocks, and gusts from the storm could sink any ship afloat. There's a boat that's sinking. We're sinking. These waters, respected and feared by sailors around the world, are off the coast of Brittany in northwest France. They're called the Passage of Ushant. Each year, shipwrecks claim the lives of dozens on board. And ecological catastrophes have happened here all too often. During stormy weather, lifeboat crews are on 24-hour standby. Professionals or just volunteers, ready to save the lives of others, even if it means risking their own. Winters are their busiest time. In the port of Brest, and the crew of the Abbaye Bourbon is monitoring weather reports. On board, the Abbaye's captain, Charles Claden, nicknamed Carlos, is getting ready to cast off. He's a legend in this town of seafarers, where over the past 20 years, he's been involved with or led most of the major local rescue operations. As soon as the winds reach 40 kilometers an hour, the authorities send us out. By then, there are storm warnings, so we might take up position close to the sea lanes. Now we're off towards Ushant, close to where there might be any trouble. Carlos steers into position exactly at the entrance to the straits. Warning, strong gusts of wind and heavy to very heavy seas. Heavy swells from the west are expected tomorrow night off the Cape of Brittany in the Atlantic. Close to Ushant, the first gusts are being felt. As he heads further out to sea, Carlos's vessel passes an increasing number of local boats sailing in the opposite direction. Sailors here know it's unwise to risk the open seas in stormy weather. Fishermen and yachtsmen alike are all heading for shelter. After a one-hour journey, the Abbaye arrives off the island of Ushant. In the Bay of Stiff, well protected by a natural rock barrier. Here, the tugboat is in its element, at the entrance to the straits, ready to aid those in distress at a moment's notice. Over the past 20 years, Carlos has come to know the waters of Ushant well. There are some very strong currents. There's mist and there's rocks scattered just about everywhere around. And there are a lot of vessels that use these waters. Merchant ships, of course. So we weigh up all the factors and elements each time a ship gets close. And on average, there are about 150 vessels that come through here a day. In the Cotentin area, there are 250 to 300 ships a day. And over in the Pas-de-Calais, up here, as many as 500 a day. So the more ships there are, the more chance of a collision. In order to avoid collisions, the ships follow strict maritime traffic regulations. The boats heading west are in the red lane, those heading east in the green lanes, so-called Ushant sea lanes. And within this zone, ships are expressly forbidden to cross lanes. Outside the zone, it's a different story, however, and it's virtually a free-for-all. All sorts of vessels vie for the narrow passage, including the frequent channel ferries that cross to and fro between France and England, and the large number of fishing boats that cast their nets amidst the tankers. Enormous tankers that bear down on the sea lanes with apparent disregard to the danger. Container ships and tankers, both transporting the chemicals and fuels that Europe needs. Monsters such as these, more than 200 meters long and laden with as much freight as can be carried by 8,000 trucks, they need at least 10 kilometers to come to a halt. From the bridge, visibility is zero. These huge vessels are often the cause of some of the worst disasters at sea. At the helicopter base at Lanvéoc near Brest, rescue crews are on standby. And as the weather continues to close in, know they might be called into action at any time. The weather's, well, let's say it's virile. The seas are now very heavy, so we'll soon see what'll happen in this area. Didier Guzmini, also known as Gus, is ready to take off. Aged 50, Gus is one of the most experienced pilots in the French Navy. He's clocked up 6,500 hours in the air, been involved in hundreds of rescue operations, and saved the lives of dozens of people. Next door, meteorologist Philippe Tonnerre is focusing on the depression that is threatening to get worse. What concerns him most is the cumulus nimbus clouds, which are a threat to the helicopter pilots. Some of them, which are, well, let's say, well-developed, can smash a plane in two. They're extremely violent, and there's a lot of ice locked up in those clouds, which could freeze an airplane. It's exactly what you don't want if you're flying. And of course, inside there's also lightning, electrical interference, every kind of weather phenomena you could come across in this sort of cloud. The storm is increasing in intensity. Back at base, Gus is getting the latest weather updates. 40 knots out there, 290, rain and partial storm conditions. There's good radar indicators, and you'll be up against 50 knot winds. 50 knots, eh? Well, easily 40 on average. In addition to the weather, there's also some other bad news. A barge has slipped loose from its tugboat. The rogue barge is 90 meters long, 40 meters wide, the size of a soccer pitch, 1,700 tons of steel that could easily sink a fishing boat or eviscerate a cargo vessel. At Marine Operation Headquarters, the nerve center is in this bunker, usually out of bounds to the cameras. The crisis unit has gathered to decide what action to take. The progress of the storm is followed live on the screens. It's a potential danger, because if it runs aground, well, you can imagine something as big as a soccer pitch made of steel. It could crush just about anything. It could do some serious damage. The barge has to be brought under control, and quickly. Guzmini and his crew get the order from the commander. On board the helicopter are five men, including a diver. out at sea, the weather is getting even worse. It's going to get pretty rough out there. We'll just try and monitor it. Every time Guzmin and his crew head out to sea, they know they're putting their lives at risk. You really want to have to do this, really like doing this. It's a matter of being organized, having your head screwed on straight and getting down to business. It's not something every pilot could do, but most of the pilots in the fleet are experienced and are those that make up the rescue crews. We're trained for this. What are the qualities to make up a good pilot? Not sure there are qualities as such, just a matter of experience. The Abbé is on the scene too. Its job, to tow the barge. Not an easy task, and it'll need help from Gus's helicopter. Luckily, the storm seems to abate. The weather conditions aren't quite as bad as the experts thought they might be, which is a good job. With a depression stopping just a few hundred meters away, Guzmini arrives in the area. That must be the barge down there on the right. And there's the Abbé. Yep, that must be it. The Abbé Bourbon gets into position. I'm going to reduce speed. The Abbé reverses into position. If she strikes the barge, she might sink. Guzmini hovers overhead, ready to help out. A few cable lengths away, the Italian tug that lost the barge. The Abbé continues on its course. Guzmini positions his helicopter ready for action when the storm suddenly takes a turn for the worse. They're shipping water now, damn it. Despite 7 meter swells, the Abbé gradually gets closer. I can see some lathes on board and at least two containers. The tug is now just a few dozen meters from the barge. Everyone is in position and the operation can begin. Vertical arrival. There are two phases. The first is for the helicopter to pick up the technician on board the Abbé. Forward 3 meters. We'll pull them. Ready? 3, 2, 1, pull. 80 feet, 90 feet. Go left. 100 feet, 110 feet. 110 feet. 130. Good, we've taken them off the boat. Okay, here they are. Let's unhook them. The second phase is dropping the technician onto the rogue barge. Before that, though, a diver on board the helicopter heads down to secure the vessel. Buffeted by the storm, the barge sways wildly, rising and falling 7 or 8 meters. 100 feet. Keep an eye on the Abbé. It's over there, right in the middle. Stop. Ahead. Vertical. Try and hold this position.
On est bien là.
60 feet. The diver is going down. Vertical. Any wrong move and the diver might crash into the barge. A meter to go. Platform's moving. He's down. Hook is loose. I'm bringing up the hook. Perfect. Well, it's a real mess down there. The barge has been wrecked by the storms. Okay, she's ready. Get ready to descend. Now it's the turn of the technician from the Abbé to go down at the end of the wire. He's ready. He's outside and descending. 5 meters. The diver from the chopper is responsible for making sure the technician gets onto the barge. Stop. Forward. Okay, the diver's got him. He's down. And the hook is free. As far as Gus is concerned, the first part of the mission is a complete success. In the meanwhile, the Abbé Bourbon continues its approach. The crew is preparing to launch ropes across to the two men on the stricken vessel. To make this task easier, the Abbé is now just a short distance away from the barge. See how close they're getting now to the barge? That's impressive. They're not scared of anything, those boys. The rope is launched and the diver and technician on board the barge secure the line. The barge is now attached to the Abbé. Its wild ride finally over. The operation is a success. The shipping lanes have been made safe. The Abbé heads back to port with the barge in tow. Yet another mission accomplished by Guzmini. In his career, he's helped save not just many ships from sinking, but also many human lives. How long have you been doing this? More than 30 years. Have you kept track of how many rescues or how many people you've saved? Yes, I'm at 167, 168 with this one. But to Gus, what's important is not just helping to avoid catastrophes and saving the lives of sailors. The job of a pilot is to take his craft, fly it where it needs to go, carry out his mission, and bring it and the entire crew back safely. It's a point of honor for me to head out with my crew on difficult missions and to bring everyone back home in one piece. So that way, I don't have someone's wife who comes up to me one day and says, "What did you do?" And for more than 20 years, Gus has always brought everyone safely back home. One of the reasons he's so respected by the men of 32F Squadron. 32F is the Lamvayok Squadron, 7 Super Frelon helicopters crewed by a team of 80 men on constant standby. These are exceptionally powerful machines, equally capable of flying by night and in the worst weather. Here we're really at the tip of France. It's a bit like the end of the earth. And obviously it's an important fishing area. Lots of small ports all around. Fishermen set sail in often really terrible conditions. Well, at least they know that we're here. So if they get into trouble, they're not too worried. They're the ones you need to help often then. Well, fairly often. Thierry is one such fisherman. He's been plying the waters off Cape Finisterre for lobster and fish for more than 25 years. He started going to sea at age 14. He is now what is known as a fishing boss. The boat belongs to him, and he has a crew of 2. On board, there is plenty of potentially dangerous equipment. It's a dangerous job. We spend, 75% of our time on water. And the majority of the French people work 35 hours a week. We can do 35 hours in just 2 days sometimes. Hard work and sacrifice, since fishing has to pay to maintain the boat and feed Thierry's family. At sea, the saying goes, life gets harder and harder for the fishermen. Thierry and his small crew often work 2 days and 2 nights non-stop, without rest or sleep, always on their feet. We do work really long hours sometimes, so long that the body says stop. I've known one guy who suffered from a broken bone, a fracture caused entirely by tiredness. He was so tired that when he fell just 10 centimeters, he broke a bone, just from being tired. There's other things too, like your back. Our backs are strained during this sort of work, so there are lots of sailors who have back problems. Plus, we're always wet, always under stress, so our bodies get run down after a while. Not to mention the dangers from storms, which can wash a man overboard. Thierry doesn't need the weather forecast to know when bad weather is on its way. Sure, if there are thousands of seabirds looking for food off your stern, that's a sure sign of bad weather. And then there are what we call the madmen of Bassante, the birds that come out in bad weather. Then you really know that conditions are going to be bad. And on this particular afternoon, the so-called madmen are there. A few hours later, the winds pick up force. Each wave is a struggle. Thierry is worried. Things might get dangerous. We'll put this one. Take yours off, Fred. But work has to continue. Fishing requires the same rhythm of work, casting and pulling up the nets, regardless of the weather. Fishing nets are to the stern, and it's tough to maneuver the boat in such conditions. And safety measures are basic. No life vests, no harnesses. This is the kind of weather that often leads to accidents on fishing boats. Thierry and his crew are approaching the shipping lanes. It's essential to take extra care and to keep a lookout for some of the huge vessels, like supertankers, that use these waters. A few moments later, a huge transporter looms a short distance in front of them, 200 meters long and tens of thousands of tons. Any collision and the damage would definitely be one-sided. We don't exist as far as he's concerned. You have to be more and more careful these days, as the crew members on ships like those are less and less efficient. There's 15 nationalities, and unless you speak 15 languages, there's only sign language to make yourself understood on board. It's not the best solution. At nighttime, the risks are greater still. Little visibility and sometimes even less caution. Like most fishing masters, it's Thierry who's at the helm in the bridge. There seems to be no other traffic, so Thierry uses the radio to chat to other fishermen to pass the time. You're usually all alone in the bridge, so it's a way of having some sort of company. We kid around sometimes. A little further south, at the naval airbase at Lambiwe, the pilots are scrambling. There's an alert, and the Falcon pilots are being briefed at Operations HQ. We've been told we need to assist a Super Frelon helicopter mission. That's providing emergency medical attention to an injured sailor from a fishing boat. He needs to be taken to hospital as quickly as possible. An injured sailor at sea. The boat is too far out, and given the urgency, an airlift is the only viable solution. The Falcon 50 readies for takeoff. It will soon reach the fishing boat. Sea rescue missions follow the same pattern. The Falcon takes off first to locate the fishing vessel. A few minutes later, the helicopter lifts off from Lambeok. The Falcon will provide the chopper with all the necessary information to enable the injured sailor to be saved. At the Lambeok helicopter base, military medic Dr. Christophe Bombert is getting ready. What do you know about the patient, doctor? Well, I know he's a 41-year-old fisherman. He was working at the ship's stern. When a huge wave knocked him down. We know he's badly hurt his knee. But whether it's just strained or broken, we can't tell until we get on board. The crew is ready to take off. The pilot issues the latest information about the rescue mission. It's a 23-meter fishing boat. The waves are at 5 meters, winds 25 knots. We have 2.5 tons of fuel on board, which in theory means we can spend 40 minutes at the location. As for the rest, there's a Falcon that's taking off in 2 minutes from Lorient, which will help guide us to the boat and let us know what the latest weather conditions are like. It's a typical rescue mission. But with 5-meter-high waves, it's a challenge for even the most experienced crews. At the back, the noise is such that crew members communicate by sign language. The Falcon has taken off, heading due north. On board the Falcon, and not long after takeoff, it spots the fishing boat. She's called the Laura. The Falcon makes radio contact. The helicopter arrives on the scene. The pilot asks the Laura's captain to position his boat to facilitate the rescue. Hello, this is the helicopter. Please head 280 degrees at 5 knots, if possible. Copy that, 280 at 5 knots. Laura from the helicopter, I'm going to approach head first. I'm going to lower a diver, and then a doctor, and then, depending on the injured man's condition, a basket in which to airlift him off. I have visual contact. Copy that. Yes to visuals. It's rolling a bit. 20 feet and probably 15 knots. To evacuate the injured fisherman, the chopper must perform what is known as a relative stationary flight. In other words, fly backwards over the boat as it sails forward, maintaining a constant speed, by no means easy in high winds and heavy seas. 40 feet, vertical is good. At the end of the winch, the diver. He goes first to later help the doctor down. He's on the bridge. Unhooked. Dr. Bombert is lowered onto the fishing boat. He's down. The doctor heads straight for the cabin to look at the patient and to determine whether he needs to be evacuated. We'll soon have been flying for 1 hour. Fuel consumption is good, and the machine is functioning properly. The injured man is on the bridge. The doctor has strapped his right leg and decides he can be airlifted up with a diver. No need for a basket. The doctor is the first to be taken off so he can get things ready for the injured man. The sailor is called Serge Le Calvez. It's the first time he's been hurt in 20 years as a fisherman. The accident caused by a huge wave that swept him against the superstructure. They're at the door. We're removing the strap from the injured man. He'll follow on behind. Airlift terminated. We're taking the injured person to Brest. Dr. Bombert will brief the hospital staff, who will then take over care for the fishermen. Well, there was really heavy seas and he lost his balance. He tripped over a board and a sudden forced rotation of his leg. He says he felt something snap.
Ok, donc c'est par là. Bon.
Je sais pas, mais.
Ça y est, c'est la fin de la mission pour vous.
The end of your part of the mission. As far as we're concerned, we're finished. I've briefed the doctors and the emergency unit here fully, and everything's fine.
Allez, bon courage.
Good luck, hein.
Là, on va se remettre en stand-by pour la prochaine.
So let's get ready for the next call. Sunday night, and it's not over yet, you know.
C'est grave là ce qu'il a ou pas?
Was it serious, his injury? Well, clinically speaking, it wasn't that serious. He'll need x-rays though, just to make sure there's nothing really wrong. He'll need to rest his leg. You know, and make sure it isn't moved.
C'est un accident classique pour un marin pêcheur, finalement, vous devez en voir souvent des bobos comme ça.
Yeah, I'd say about 3/4 of all the injuries are similar to this one. We'd better go now. The x-rays show a triple fracture of the tibia and knee. Fishermen are often the victims of accidents, or worse, at sea. Ports across Brittany routinely witness incidents, and many families have lost loved ones. This is Guilvinec, one of the largest fishing ports in Brittany. Over the years, countless fishermen or sailors from this port have been lost at sea. Marguerite's husband perished in 1973. Time, however, has not fully healed the pain of loss. Within a few minutes of the accident, I had everyone coming by to see me. The mayor and all sorts of people to come and tell me all about it. What time was it, in fact? It was 10:20 in the morning, precisely. I look at that quite often. It's still painful to me. When you see all these people coming to see you, it's quite something, you know.
Très impressionnant.
Quite something. What's this here? Well, when they come and tell you that there's a missing person, then you wonder what you've done to deserve this.
Vous demandez si elle vous tombe pas sur la tête, quoi.
Marguerite's husband was a fisherman on board the Danny Gérard. In 1973, when it was sunk by a Soviet cargo vessel, it disappeared with all hands.
Le pire, c'est quand on trouve pas les corps.
The worst thing is when the bodies are never found.
Vous êtes sûr,
when they find something, then you know that it's him. But otherwise, you always ask yourself, the children were always saying he might come back someday. Something which I didn't really. Albert and Marguerite had been married for 10 years, with two small boys. The oldest boy is now also a sailor, something that Marguerite dreaded. I tried my best to stop him from going to sea. I tried everything. Everything. I even went into a depression, I swear it, to try and make him change his mind. I saw all the experts and doctors, but no, it was the only thing he wanted to do. With her son at sea, Marguerite began living with fear once again. I never wanted to listen to the radio again. The radio, constantly tuned to the fisherman's frequency. Marguerite is glued to the radio when her son is out at sea, as is the case today. He started on the Condor. Now, that was the first one. He was just 16 years old. I said I wouldn't even buy another radio. I didn't want to have to listen to go through all that again. It was so long. It was 7 years after, later. 7 years after what? Well, 7 years after his father disappeared, when he started going to sea. The memorial to those lost at sea is in the Loch Tudy Cemetery. These are all the boats that have been lost. There's quite a few. On the other side, a plaque with the name Danny Gérard. It's this one here, you see. When her husband Albert was killed, he was only 35 years old. The latest plaque on the memorial is for the Bugald Brege, which disappeared at sea 3 years ago. With each tragedy, Marguerite is reminded of her own terrible loss. It's like it's all happening over again. Every time there's a boat that sinks? Oh yeah, every time it's the same. I get goosebumps. And it's the same feelings all over again.
Les émotions. C'est ça. Et oui, et puis on dit à quand les années.
You always hope it'll be the last one. But unfortunately, it never will be. You see, there's still plenty of room on the memorial. The fishing trawler Bugald Brege, with a crew of five on board, went missing on the 15th of January 2004. Debris from the ship was discovered a few weeks later, but the bodies of those missing have never been found. Human error, collision, everyone has their own theory. Some say a submarine dragged the boat down. Despite an inquest, the disappearance has never been satisfactorily explained. More recently, another fishing boat, the Klein Familie, sank off Cherbourg. The port was stunned by the news. just a few hours after the news of the disappearance, the father of the captain loses all hope. I'm waiting for them to find my son. After that, well, I'm sure it was struck by another vessel. It couldn't be anything else. I mean, there are no rocks down there. And then, well, I'm really cross for me and for the others, because these stupid things will keep happening. So, you know, other ships will come along. It'll always be like that. And it's just the way it is. Of the crew of five, just one will survive. The survivor, almost by miracle, is Jean-Michel Guénot, the youngest crew member. For as long as he could remember, Jean-Michel had wanted to become a sailor. Since the incident, he's never set foot on a boat again. This is where we would dock, right here. And he's never spoken of what happened, until now. How long were you on board the vessel? Well, I worked on board for 9 months. We were five lads in the crew, and we'd head out to sea every day, just about. We'd leave with the tide. Whatever time the tide was, we'd set sail, day or night. Then when I was having a nap, I was woken up by a huge bang and I was thrown out of the berth. And then I'm not really sure what happened next. I suppose I managed to swim, because I remember I was underwater, and then I reached the surface somehow. Up there, I only saw one other lad. I don't know what, the others probably were unconscious, I don't know, or I couldn't hear them. But I could hear one guy. It was Olivier. I tried to reach him, but I couldn't. He was yelling and hanging on to a float, and he was drifting further and further away. So I decided to try and swim out to him. I jumped back into the sea and tried as hard as I could to swim out to where he was. But I couldn't catch up with him. At that point, I went back to the life raft and got back in. I knew he was in danger, but soon afterwards, there was nothing. I couldn't hear him anymore. There was no yelling. I couldn't hear him anymore. Olivier and the rest of the crew were never found. From the moment I was in the life raft, I began thinking about God and stuff like that. All at once, I found religion. I was repeating, my God, things like that, the whole time. I was alone, just waiting to die, thinking, why didn't I go down with the boat? I should have, I was thinking. Do you think if a cargo vessel hits you, don't you think they'd have realized? They would have felt something? Well, they must have, because if the Klein Familia was a small boat, it was still about 60 tons, so you'd think they would realize, yeah, they'd have felt something. They should have stopped at least. Does that make you angry? I was cross, because when you see it sailing on, you think, well, it should stop and check, see what happened, try and help or something. You think my friend might have been saved. And then you just see it carrying on, leaving. How big was it? What kind of cargo vessel was it? Oh, it was big. It was huge. When you're in the water anyway, it feels like you're tiny, minuscule. And compared to us anyway, it was huge. How far away was it when you saw it? I was only about 20 meters away from where I was. It was plowing straight ahead on its course. Nothing was going to stop it. It was just going straight on. Yeah, it was like we are the ones that had to get out of the way. The guilty ship is assumed to be the Sichem Pandora, a freighter flying the Maltese colors. On its bow, investigators discovered traces of paint that match those of the Klein Familia. The wreck of the trawler has been filmed at the bottom of the sea, but cannot be shown due to the legal proceedings that are underway. The lawyer for the Klein family is one of the few to have seen the video. What you see is a ship that's been completely ripped apart, a boat that's been violently struck, the stem that's still in one piece, which means the Klein Familia didn't hit another vessel, but indeed the very opposite happened. The bridge is totally destroyed, but the signal lights, buoys, and the fishing gear used by the crew are still intact. So 3 days after the collision, some of the material on board was still functioning. This proves that Klein Familie was perfectly visible to other shipping. And if the ship that crashed into the trawler had taken the usual precautions and had a proper watch, this would never have happened. The incident is the subject of legal proceedings in Malta, where the freighter was registered. And until the trial begins, the Seychem Pandora is still at liberty. Every time a fishing boat returns to port, the families of the crew breathe a sigh of relief, at least until it sets sails again. Marguerite was always anxious to see her husband return safely. Used to come and wait for him every time? Always. All the families, including the kids when they weren't at school, we all used to come out to the docks and wait for Dad. The Laura is coming back to port today, after 2 weeks at sea. And the wives have gathered at the dockside. It was the Laura that had called in the rescue services to airlift its injured sailor.
Okay, je baisse mes radios.
Oui.
Vous êtes paré derrière.
Et vous arrivez au niveau des roues.
On va sortir ici.
Et au niveau du cargo. Ok, on va le rentrer doucement avec sa jambe. Ouais.
70 ici.
Ok, ils sont dans le cargo.
Le départ, c'est pas bon, mais l'arrivée, c'est...
When they leave, it's awful. But when they return, it's wonderful. I mean, after all, they've been away for 2 weeks. If it was just 2 or 3 days, that would be fine, but 2 weeks is a long time. And we worry the whole time they're away. It's hard, very hard for the wives and for the men who are out at sea. It's hard for everyone, especially when the weather's bad, and it's absolutely awful. Hi, remember me? How are you? How was it? Nasty weather, very cold. Still, the sun's shining now. How's Serge doing? Well, it'll be another month or so before he's up and about. So he'd have been out of action for 3 or 4 months altogether? Well, on a 2-week-long trip, anything might happen. Oh, things that break down, don't work, someone who gets hurt is less common. But it happens, unfortunately. You just got to keep going and deal with it. Oh, there's a lot of stress. That's why we always look forward to returning home to our wives. We hope they can help us relax. But it's not always the case. Yeah, but you're at home for such a short time that we can't really take care of you how we'd like to. You sort of lose the habit. Time on shore is always brief. A few days later, another accident means the rescue services are on full alert. At 3 a.m. on the 31st of January, the Ecce, a freighter transporting chemicals, is struck by another ship. The 22-strong crew is airlifted to safety by British helicopters stationed in the Channel Islands. This time, no one is hurt. In the Ecce's hold is 10,000 tons of phosphoric acid. A potential environmental catastrophe looms. Early morning, and Didier Guzmini and his men are deployed to the deserted vessel. We're going to drop some experts on board to evaluate the dangers. The chemical is extremely dangerous. There's a risk of pollution then. Oh yeah, definitely a big risk. Carlos is part of the rescue mission. The captain of the Abbé is called upon for his technical expertise to determine whether the Ecce can be towed back to port and therefore avoid a catastrophe. You just don't know. The freighter could sink within the hour or keep floating for another 2 weeks. We need to find out exactly what the situation is and to see what measures need to be taken. The divers will investigate how bad the breach in the hull is and see what can be done, and especially to check whether the chemicals on board have begun leaking into the sea. A 30-minute flight, and the helicopter is over the ship. At first sight, there's no sign of any leaks. The acid seems to be still in the hold, but the ship is listing badly. Oh, it doesn't look good, does it? We must have taken a real whack. Bloody hell, doesn't look good at all. A few hundred meters away is the General Grocki, a 200-meter-long Maltese freighter that is believed to have collided with the Ecce in the middle of the night. The Argonaut, a high-seas tug, arrives on the scene. It's equipped with underwater cameras that will examine the ship's hull to determine the risk of pollution and for evidence of the ship that ran into it. French Navy divers film the ship's hull, and it's an awesome sight. The Ecce has been eviscerated. Towards the stern, the hold has been partially breached, and acid is slowly leaking out. The situation is critical. With nightfall approaching, the ship runs the risk of being struck a second time by other shipping in the area. Are you ready? Cables are launched as the Abbé attempts to make fast the Ecce and tow it to shore. All seems to be proceeding well, but it's still a long way to the port of Cherbourg. 2 a.m, and Stéphane and his crew are woken to be informed about another ship that is maneuvering close to the Ecce and appears to be ignoring warnings issued by the authorities. We're off. They need to scramble. The latest news is extremely worrying. The ship continues to zigzag through the shipping lanes. It's changed its course now by 3:50. What's its latest position? Do you have it? As of 2:30, yes. The Ecce is not the only boat in danger. The ferries that connect France and England crisscross this section of the channel. On board, hundreds of unsuspecting passengers. A collision with the errant ship could be disastrous. The rescue mission has to locate it as quickly as possible. I'm reducing altitude. Okay, 130 feet, 55 knots. Leveling out at 100 feet. The vessel is soon spotted. It appears to be a Dutch fishing boat. Its coordinates are passed onto the control center on the mainland. It's a small fishing trawler. I'm somewhat astonished to see what it's doing. I can see no one on board. Anybody seen anybody down there? There's no one on the bridge. No sign of life. And the boat's name is barely visible on the hull. The crew might be asleep. Stéphane tries to rouse them on the radio.
Shipping vessel Wintercruise, shipping vessel Wintercruise, this is French Navy helicopter on your backside. Do you read me? Over.
Still no answer.
Wintercruise, shipping vessel Wintercruise, this is French Navy helicopter on your backside. Do you read me? Over.
No answer. So the powerful spotlight is directed into the boat's cabin.
Fishing vessel Wintercruise, this is French Navy helicopter on your backside.
Finally, there's a response on the radio.
Yes, you're the fishing vessel.
Could you spell the name of your ship, please?
It's the UK 24, uniform kilo 240.
And could you give me your port of call, please?
The port of call.
Last port of call was Boulogne, in France.
Ok, bon allez, c'est bon. Okay. Ça suffit. Déjà ils sont réveillés, j'ai pas mal.
Ok.
The boat has been identified, and the danger seems past.
Très probablement la personne à la barre.
I guess the person on board wasn't too concerned about the radio, so he kept communications to a minimum and probably ignored it. Wouldn't surprise me.
Il a visé les contacts et je pense qu'il a fait un petit peu la sourde oreille pour pas avoir parlé à la radio. C'est assez probable.
Is that it then, as far as the boat's concerned? Well, pretty much in this case, we know its name, what it's doing. We know it's a fishing boat. We'll make some inquiries: who it is, where it's from, what it's up to.
Monsieur Chris from helicopter. Thank you, sir. Good night and good day.
Thank you, sir. Same to you. Over now.
This time, the boat won't be sanctioned, but any future incidents in French waters, and it could be detained. At sunrise, the Abbé, which had been towing the Etche towards Cherbourg, is on its own. The freighter has sunk overnight. Well, last night at about 10 o'clock, the ship began really listing badly. And at that point, we knew it was all over. It lay on its side and stayed afloat until about 3:30 or so this morning, and then it finally sank at 3:38. The Etche is now 70 meters below the surface, with its dangerous chemical cargo threatening to leak out of its hold. Both British and French authorities monitor the area constantly. We're checking that there's been no spill, no leaks, and therefore no pollution. So the ships, helicopters and planes, either English or French, are going to be patrolling the area to check on the pollution. If there is, we'll need to go in. So you can tell just by looking if there's pollution? Yes, indeed. Any hydrocarbons or pollutant will form a slick on the surface, and it's easily visible from the air. So far, there's no slick, but the acid could leak out slowly. The Argonaut will be carefully monitoring and testing the waters. The chemist is at the exit. It's a Navy chemist who will lead the operation. He's down.
Okay, le crew est libre.
Water from the area where the ship went down is collected in the tubes and analyzed on the spot. So far, the tests are negative, and for now, there's no pollution. The surface area around the wreck remains under surveillance to this day. At Corson, near Brest, the men of the CROS, the Regional Rescue Operations Center, monitor potential polluters around the clock on radar screens.
Cargo on board. No dangerous cargo on board. We have on board 23,000 tons.
Each dot represents a ship. Some ships are highlighted in green, others in orange. The orange ones are the ones that are transporting dangerous material. This could include coal, chemical products, gas, petrol. But on this morning, it's a distress signal from a pleasure boat that focuses their attention. What does the boat look like? Small cabin, okay, small cabin, no rudder controls, 6 meters long, color? We'll take care of it, but stay close to the phone. We might need to get in touch with you again. The CROS messages all boats in the area where the boat was last seen. We are searching for an Obrim-class boat, a fishing vessel, 6 meters long, white. Please keep an eye open for this boat. Report any information you may have. Thank you. We're heading towards Saint Mathieu. We'll take a look around there, towards the coast, unless you have any other news for us. Okay, great. I'll stay on 67 on that frequency. I'll listen out for any more news and be in touch if I have any, of course.
Est-ce que tu as quelque chose en l'air actuellement là au niveau de la pointe de Corsen? Hélicoptère, avion.
Do you have anything up in the air near the Corsen point?
Donc on a mis en place. Donc c'est le réseau des sémaphores. On a demandé à Saint-Mathieu de regarder, au Steve de regarder. On n'a rien en visu, ni même nous.
We haven't seen anything yet. We're looking for a missing boat.
Il faudrait qu'on ait un appui aérien.
It would be nice to have some air support.
Yankee India du cross, oui.
67. J'appelle le navire à la position 48 degrés 12 minutes.
Calling boat at position 48 degrees 12 minutes north. Identify yourself, please, on channel 16. Over. Still no answer. The only call he seems to have made is to the repair yard to say he had a problem with his two engines. With no working engines, the boat is marooned. It could be floating helplessly in the shipping lanes, risking being crushed by a larger vessel. A picture of the missing boat is found on the internet, and the CROS uses it to provide more information. The boat must be found as quickly as possible. If the person on the boat has to spend the night at sea, he'll have some serious hypothermia problems the next morning. The temperatures drop to freezing out there, so unless he's got the right equipment on board, he's going to get really cold. But then a Coast Guard vessel reports that it's found the missing boat. We've found the boat.
You'll
sort it out on the spot with him, whether you're going to tow him back? Roger that. Each case becomes personal, really. It is a missing person, after all. So when they're located, it's still great news. Even after 5 or 6 years of doing this job, and even after hundreds of such incidents, even if the person's safe and sound and never calls in to say, here I am, I'm okay, even then we're happy. At the CROS, every call is a potential emergency, no matter how bizarre. A few weeks earlier, the center launched a search and rescue operation after an unusual phone call. Well, we got a call from someone in Paris who said, I've just heard a call from a Polish friend of mine in Poland who says her husband has just called her to say his boat is sinking off the coast of Brittany. In fact, the story was absolutely true. As the pictures show, this man, clinging to the wreck of his boat, was in the middle of the busy sea lanes. By a miracle, he'd survived more than 10 hours in this dangerous waterway. Back home in Warsaw, Janusz Kapitowski, age 68, admits he's lucky to be alive. A veteran of the Polish Navy, he was on a round-the-world solo cruise when disaster struck off the coast of France. After 6 months, without the slightest problem, just as he was entering the Straits of Ushant, his boat was struck by several huge waves. The first wave overturned the boat, but it was okay. I was able to use the pump and emptied out the boat in about 10 minutes. Then there was a huge wave that caught me by surprise. It knocked me down and crushing three ribs. And the next thing, I found myself in the water.
I znalazłem się w wodzie za poza jachtem. Udało mi się dopłynąć do jachtu.
Despite the storm, I was able to swim back to the boat and climb back on board. The mast, unfortunately, had been broken. It was in three pieces. A few hours later, Janusz saw another ship on the horizon. He was sure he was about to be saved. In the distance, I saw a freighter heading towards me. Naturally, I fired off my distress flares so that he could see me. The ship was getting closer, slowly heading my way. A couple of hundred yards, then 100. Kept getting closer, but then it sailed straight past me.
200 metrów, 100 metrów.
I could see the crew on the bridge. They were talking and laughing. There I was down in the water, screaming at the top of my voice. I managed to send up a second flare. The whole sky was lit up red from the flare, but the ship just sailed on by. In fact, I was lucky it didn't run me over. Alone in the middle of the ocean, Janusz has one slim hope left, his cell phone. Luckily, it was still working, but I'd lost my phone list, and the only number I knew of by heart was that of my wife. When I got the call from my husband, I started to cry straight away.
Pierwsza moja reakcja to
he told me to stop crying and get a grip of myself.
Po prostu, no więc mąż mnie trochę przywołał do porządku i powiedział, ty nie płacz, tylko zacznij.
And I decided, yeah, no, he was right, it wouldn't help. And then I looked for the numbers, and I found those for the rescue services, and I rang.
Ogromne zdenerwowanie jemu na pewno nie pomoże, wręcz przeciwnie, trzeba jakoś się skupić w sobie i zacząć działać, więc natychmiast tam oczywiście odszukałam te wszystkie telefony do Warty i tak dalej i zatelefonowałam.
Barbara doesn't speak French, so she rang a friend in Paris, who in turn alerted the CROS.
On a fait décoller un avion de la marine française.
We ordered up a Navy Falcon 50 aircraft, and it found a sailing ship with a broken mast.
Il a trouvé en effet un voilier avec le mât cassé.
After 10 hours in the water, it was Janusz's first ray of hope. I noticed that the plane circled twice, as in a rescue mission. It circled over me and then headed back to land. I was sure then at this point that it had spotted me and I was about to be saved, because I was the only guy out there in the sea. The Falcon radios the closest ship and asks her to pick up Janusz, which is not an easy maneuver. The seas were quite strong at the time, and they were looking just for a small boat. But we had found it, we had its exact position, and an infrared image from the rear navigator. At that point, we were concerned that the container vessel had not seen it or would not be able to maneuver in time, because the sea was so rough. Despite the bad weather, the freighter was able to perform brilliantly. It was even more skillful since it had to sail past the sailing boat in order to align itself properly alongside, so as to hoist the skipper up on board from his boat using a rope ladder along its hull.
Le skipper à bord de son bateau par une échelle de corde qui va le mettre le long de sa coque.
You can see how small my yacht was in comparison to the freighter. I could see the man who was coming to help me up the ladder. I thought I'd never make it, It was a long climb up, believe me, and the sea was very choppy. The waves would lift me 5 or 6 meters and then take me right down again, even below water. The skipper's body temperature was 35 degrees, and he was in a state of shock. So we radioed the CROS to let them know about his condition, and they decided right away to medevac him off. The first medical attention was given by Dr. Bombert. He still remembers the moment well. When I finished my examination, I told the diver, okay, we can hoist him over. So we helped him up and explained what was going on. And then there were cheers from the ship's crew. And the way the sailors and the Pole looked at each other, well, you knew that they knew a life had been saved that day. Well, even today, I can't really find the right words to express all my gratitude. They were real sailors, these people. And it was their determination that saved my life. It was and still is a very emotional experience for me. It makes me cry just to think about it. Amateur sailors are not the only ones to be caught out by sudden bad weather. Trinité-sur-Mer is the home port of Laurent Bourgnon, one of the best sailors in the world, and twice the winner of the Route de Rhum Round the World Yacht Race. Bourgnon has been sailing in the waters around Brittany ever since he was young. He knows them well.
La Bretagne,
listen, the weather around here can really sneak up and surprise you. There are sudden tides, there's hidden rocks, things like that. You know, as the saying goes, if you can navigate your way around Brittany, then you can just about sail anywhere in the world. It's one of the toughest areas in the world for sailors here. And Bourgnon knows tough. More than 20 years ago, he sailed single-handed across the Atlantic in a hobby, a tiny catamaran with no equipment on board whatsoever. It bordered on lunacy. I encountered several storms on the way, huge walls of water that crashed down on top of me. Extremely violent, but there's not much you can do, just pray. And that's when the fear might overwhelm you. A few years later, and his reputation as one of the best skippers in the world was established by winning several single-handed races. A large part of the work is just concentrating on staying alive, to keep the boat on course in the right direction, and to focus on what the vessel is doing and adjust depending on the elements. So if you stop concentrating, even for just a moment, things can go really badly. In 1996, he takes part in the British Transatlantic Race. On the fourth day, the rescue services receive a distress signal from Laurent Bourgnon. His trimaran has been overcome by a storm. There were heavy seas. We were just in front of a weather depression, and about 24 hours later, a Filipino freighter, which was carrying iron ore, which was the ship nearest to me at the time, approached me. And in a quite remarkable maneuver towards the wind, managed to send me a large rope over, which meant I could climb up onto the freighter. The crew was really fantastic. I had a great welcome. They treated me wonderfully. You see, because when you're out in the ocean, you're just a small thing there, so, you know, this kind of camaraderie is fantastic. And when you're sailing single-handed, you know, things can go wrong. So it was great to get a helping hand like that. It's something you should never forget, but unfortunately, back in Paris, sometimes you do. Today, Laurent Bourgnon has stopped racing, but he still sails off the coast of Brittany. Okay, take care, guys. And he's never forgotten his rescue at sea. It's not just the professionals that act as guardian angels. In every port in Brittany, volunteers risk their lives to save those in peril at sea. These are the volunteers of the Aberash in the Finistère. No storm ever stops these men from going out to sea. Oh, it's good for your health. At the wheel is Jeannot Le Troidec. With him, bakers, teachers, fishermen make up his crew. They are all volunteers. The guys with me here are volunteers. They want to be here, so they really try their best. Each man in this crew has saved the life of at least one sailor in peril. Their speciality seems to be rescues near the coast, helping those whose ships have run aground, as these library pictures make clear during a rescue operation. Later, and there would have been no survivors. Back on land, Jeannot works at the Port Authority. He agrees to be filmed, but insists that he is no hero. A rescue mission is just to help the others. I mean, it might be us one day. Or it could be your brother, or one day it might even be our son. It doesn't matter who it is, or that we know them or not. I believe all sailors around the world would go to the others' assistance. It's a tradition that, unfortunately, though, is disappearing. No sailor would want to leave another sailor, in the shit. Despite their courage, the volunteer rescue services sometimes can only do so much. But once, quite by chance, we came across a canoe that had been turned over, and amongst those who had disappeared was a child. His father was still alive. We warmed up the survivors. We took some of them home and then went looking for the boy and the others. The next day they were found. But it was a ship from Saint-Malo that actually picked them up. But it wasn't a good experience. It brought tears to our eyes, actually, knowing that the father had held his boy's hand for 7 hours and that he'd finally had to let go. Just thinking of that and knowing how the father must have felt, thinking, I've lost my son, it must have been terrible. In churches throughout Brittany, there are memorials to those lost at sea. The rescuers remain modest, though. The sea is dominant because it's far stronger than we are. So occasionally we do get the worst of it. If we try to get smart, it will tell us, be careful because I know that I will win. When the sea is calm, Jeannot spends time fixing up his boat. He's been doing this for more than 20 years. Well, I don't think we're playing with death. No, I've never really felt scared. Worried, of course. Shaking hands, wobbly legs. It's just anxiety, though. You have to overcome it. It's just in your head. That's where panic sets in, and the more you panic, the more trouble you'll find yourself in. And then you freeze up totally. But I've never really been scared when I'm in the thick of it. It's afterwards that you start thinking about it, and I think, well, that was close. Too close, maybe. In 1986, some of the volunteers paid with their lives. We lost 5 friends. We never really knew what happened to them. They left one night to go and help a sailing boat. that had asked for assistance. The weather was bad, the weather was really bad. 5 or 6 meter high waves. It was a bit like this morning. They then lost power on board, a blackout, which means that you're in heavy seas like that. You've lost your radar, you have nothing. 5 crew, 5 dead.
5 à bord, 5 morts.
Every time Jeannot leaves port, he thinks of his 5 friends. Volunteers like him, who died trying to save others. Whenever I go past here, it's like visiting the grave of a close family member. There was a strong current and heavy winds, and they were swept there onto the rocks in just a few seconds, despite attempts to anchor the ship, because later they found the chain and the anchor. It had been not strong enough to stop them. They even tried to put their life raft out to sea, but it was too late. The ship was tossed between those 2 rocks there. It turned over and just broke up. And we found the wreck over there, behind there. And you always think of them when you go past here. Of course, yes, always. This winter, off the coast of Brittany, the rescue teams were called out more than 1,500 times. They saved dozens of lives, although the sea claimed some too. And there were no ecological disasters along the coastline.